The lesson from the New Testament for this morning is found in Hebrews 11, 1 through 2, 8 through 10, on page 175 of the New Testament in the Pew Bibles. Listen for the Word of God. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Indeed, by faith, our ancestors received approval. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to set out for a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. And he set out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he stayed for a time in the land he had been promised, as in a foreign land, living in tents, as did Isaac and Jacob, who were heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked forward to the city that has foundations, where architect and builder is God. The lesson from the Old Testament for this morning is found in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 9, on page 7 of the Old Testament in the Pew Bibles. Listen for God's word. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went as the Lord has told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abram took his wife Sarai and his brother's son Lot and all the possessions that they had gathered and the persons whom they acquired in Haran, and they set forth to go to the land of Canaan. When they had come to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to where the oak of Moreh. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring, I will give you this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who appeared to him. From there, he moved on to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on by stages toward Negev. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jan, because I didn't give you
kind names in that passage. Let's pray. Lord, as we come to this passage, as we come to this book that has so many expectations and so many stories and so many interpretations, so much baggage, we ask that your Spirit would be strong with us. We ask that you would send your Spirit to give us clarity so your word may shine through. For we know that it's only by your strength, by your gracious action, that we're able to do anything. While my feeble words will prove empty, you alone have the words of life. And so may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be holy and acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Have you ever come into a movie halfway, and for the rest of the movie sat there trying to figure out what the plot was, figuring out character names and the conflict and who's on what side and who associates with who, and what is this all leading towards? Several years ago, Katie got into the Harry Potter series, And I bought her the box set of the DVDs, and I started watching with her, but I started watching in on the fourth movie. And so as I'm going through, I'm trying to piece together, okay, this is, Harry is a good guy. I got that pretty quickly. I can get that one. I figured out some of the family relations, the red hair all in one family helped me tremendously. That helped. And I'm trying to figure out the plot and who's good and who's bad. And then I finally, after we got through the final movie, because I started in the fourth movie and went on through the two seventh movies, I went back and I watched the first three movies, and I thought, oh, well, that makes a lot of sense now. We've done this because, you know, a friend or a spouse or a significant other will be watching a movie and we'll come into the room and say, oh, what's this? It's interesting. And you watch and you can pick up on some of the basics, but that full plot you don't really get until you go back and watch the beginning and see the way things were set up and who's what and who has what backstory. That's kind of what happens, and I'm indebted to one of my professors for this image. That's kind of what happens when we start reading the Bible at Matthew. We like the New Testament. We like the stories of Jesus. They're a little less obscure than the stories in the Old Testament. The Old Testament has even weirder names, even weirder stories, even weirder outcomes. And so we stick with what we know. We stick with the New Testament. But starting with that is like starting in the middle of the Harry Potter series. You kind of get a grasp of what's going on. You know at the end it's very good. When Harry wins, sorry, spoiler alert. But you don't quite get the full plot. And so today we begin a series in Genesis. We're going to start talking in Genesis, and I realize that we're starting at chapter 12, so we've already gone over a few thousand years of history, most likely. But we're going to start in Genesis, and we're going to talk about God's faithfulness to God's people. Genesis comes with a lot of baggage, doesn't it? From the very first chapter of Genesis, we have expectations and we have ideas about what it's saying and we have thoughts about what it is and what it isn't and how it's wrong in this way and how it's right in this way and literal seven-day creation or an intelligent design or full evolution or what do we do with it all? The question becomes, how do we read Genesis? And that's one of the primary tasks when we come to the book, is figuring out what is it that we have in front of us. That's the task of any reader, of course. For some reason, we ignore that when we get to the Bible. But we read certain books in certain ways. For example, my science textbook way back in high school, we read in a certain way. By contrast, I'm an English teacher, and I like to inflict literature on people. And so E.E. Cummings is an author who was known for his unconventional use of punctuation. This is part of a poem by E.E. Cummings. Now, you would not read E.E. Cummings as a grammar book. We have enough time, we have enough trouble with the grammar that we have, let alone this. There's one punctuation mark in that section. Imagine if that's how our language was. We'd have a whole different set of rules to have. And imagine if we taught our kids that this was grammar. Some of you may be saying, well, I think there are some teachers that are saying this is grammar based on the way our kids write. But you don't read E.E. Cummings as a grammar book. In the same way, you don't read L. Ron Hubbard as science rather than science fiction or Scientology. You wouldn't want to make that mistake. You don't read it that way. And you don't read a science book as poetry. We read different books in different ways. Same is true with Genesis. And Genesis has a definite form. It has definite forms, and it is just as much art as it is history. It's just as much art as it is history. As an example of this, you can have truth and art together, can't you? I'll inflict another literary person on you. Emily Dickinson is probably the only American author I like. I like British people. And so Emily Dickinson, though, has this one poem where she says, "Tell all the truth, but tell it slant. Success in circuit lies. Too firm for our great, too great for our infirm delight is truth's supreme surprise." That's Dickinson basically saying, tell people over and over again because they don't get it the first time around. Emily, why not just say that? It's art and it's truth together. In Genesis, we find art and we find truth. We find history all rolled up together. And so if we were to read it as a literal history book, we're kind of going beyond the bounds of Genesis. Reading Genesis is more like looking at a painting about history than listening to Tom Brokaw or Brian Williams, for that matter, but for a different reason. And so we have at the beginning of Genesis these 11 chapters, what I'll call primeval history. Not a great term, primeval history. It sounds very guttural. And the question that we have when you come to these first 11 books of Genesis is, what's your view on history? Moses, of course, if you read the stories in Genesis, Moses was raised in Pharaoh's court. Moses was well-educated. He's kind of like Paul in that respect. He has a good education. He has a good background. He's widely read. And so Moses was familiar with the ancient creation stories. Creation stories that by and large would tell people that, well, things started off horribly, but we're making it better. There's a movement in history that things used to be really bad, but we're making it better. We're on an upward climb. We're pulling up the bootstraps. Along comes Moses, inspired by the Holy Spirit, and writes Genesis. And in the culture that says things were bad and we're moving up, Genesis is written that says things were wonderful. Things were perfect. And we fell down. It says to the people in its culture, we're not on the way up, we're on the way down. And if you read Genesis 1 through 11, you can see that throughout the stories, Genesis 1 through 11 is this narrative of how we just never quite get it right. From trying to make our own way in the garden, from two brothers that can't get it right on their own, to the Tower of Babel. Now, this is a great story. There is humor in the Bible, folks. It's there. It's in the story of the Tower of Babel because people are coming from all over to build this great and wonderful tower to the heavens and to show how magnificent we are. And the scripture says that God had to come down from heaven just to see the tower and how small it was. God had to step down and kind of, where are my bifocals? Oh, is that what you're doing? Okay, I'm going to confuse you. And it's another human enterprise that fails, and we fail over and over and over again. The history of us trying to do it ourselves is not a pretty history. Sin, getting kicked out of a garden, killing brothers, trying to build a great monument that isn't really that great. Humanity is failing miserably since getting kicked out of the garden at fending for itself. And that's when God, Yahweh, steps onto the scene in chapter 12, and we come to our story for today. And it seems like out of nowhere that Yahweh steps into Abraham's life. At this point, he's called Abram. So if I switch back and forth, I'm trying desperately to say Abram, because he's not quite Abraham yet. We're not quite there. And God comes out of nowhere and comes to Abram. Now, Abram is nothing special if you read the scriptures. We get this idea that he's a great example of faith, that God must have chosen him for something that he was. But when you read Genesis, you don't get that before. He's the son of Terah, who worshipped foreign gods, who attempted to migrate to Canaan, but kind of camped out at Haran and said, I'm not going to go any farther. Another human enterprise that I was going to go to Canaan, but I got halfway and said, this isn't half bad. Abram is nothing special. He worships foreign gods. There's absolutely no indication that prior to this, he knows the Lord God. And God comes out of nowhere and he says, go to a land which I will show you. Go to a land which I will show you. I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you, and whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed through you. The Lord calls Abram to leave behind everything that's important to him. If you read, the translation doesn't give you quite this sense, but there are three things that God says that you need to leave. Go out from your country, from the place of your birth, and from your father's household. Abram, I want you to leave everything that connects you. I want you to leave your past entirely. Church, I want you to leave Illinois. I want you to leave the Quad City area, and I want you to leave 2324 18th Avenue. What? Now, you know me a little bit, but God's calling out of nowhere. And Abram has a decision to make. Nowhere do we get that Abram is going to say, okay, great, who are you? Again? But the Lord makes seven promises along the way. He calls Abram out of his country and he promises him seven things. He says, I'll make of you a great nation. I'll bless you materially. I'll make your name great. You will be a blessing. I'll bless those who bless you. I'll curse those who curse you. And all the families of the earth will be blessed on account of you. These seem like wonderful things. I would not mind being made into a great nation. I wouldn't mind being blessed materially. That people would be blessed because they came encountered me. But there are some problems if you know Abram and that you've read just a few verses before. First of all, I will make you into a great nation. What's the problem? A couple verses prior, we learned that Sarai, Abram's wife, is barren. Sarai is barren. How are you going to make him into a great nation? I'll bless you materially, but he's a nomad. He just kind of wanders. There are problems with the promises that any rational person would look at and say, well, that's great and all, but how are you going to do this? how is this going to happen? Because everything around me says this is not going to happen. What are you going to do, God? The ancients might not have had computers, but they were still intelligent. They still understood how the world worked. Sarai and Abram realized that age 75, kids were not in the picture anymore. It just wasn't going to happen. And Abram knew that financial and social security, in the sense of relations, came from being with your family. So given the likelihood of a strange God calling him to make a decision that makes absolutely no sense, Abram responds. And in three words, we get this monumental decision. Against all logic, we get three words. So Abram went. I can't underscore the importance of that response. It's like going to the Grand Canyon and summing it up as a big hole. So Abram went. It's like summing up D-Day simply as the Allies invaded. It doesn't get to the magnitude of what's going on here. Because Abram obeys the Lord, a strange God who's calling him out of his family, out of his home country, out of his nation, and asking him to go to a place that he doesn't even name. I want you to follow me to a land that I will show you. Hopefully this is resonating that this is not what you would do. This isn't the way that you would respond. This is a monumental decision. Abram steps out in faith. They collect all their belongings and they go. And Lot, his nephew, whose father had died, amazingly says, "Okay, I'll go with you. I'll follow you there." There's no sense that Abram asks him to go, but there's this sense that Lot might be that promised heir that Abram's going to have. That maybe through his nephew, Abram can build a family. Maybe I'll adopt my nephew and that's how we'll become a great nation together. Perhaps that's a thought on Abram's mind. And they travel and they go to the land of Canaan, where the Canaanites, they say, the scripture says, are already living. The Lord, Yahweh, leads him to Canaan and appears to Abram. And remarkably, he says, not this is yours, but he says to your offspring, I'll give this land. Called by a strange God to a strange land for a promise that now he's not even going to see. And what's Abram's response to this promise that to your offspring I'll give this land? It's not, I don't think that was quite the arrangement we had. If you go back on the contract, you said that you'll make me a great nation, that I will have lots of descendants, you're going to bless me materially. There was no mention that this would go to my offspring. It's like winning the lottery and having the state of Illinois say, congratulations, this will all go to your son after you're dead. Excuse me? Now, maybe you're laughing because we could imagine the state of Illinois saying that. But it's still odd and it's still tough to wrestle with. But Abram's response is he builds an altar, which is the way in Genesis of saying, he worshiped. Abram's response to this promise is to worship the Lord. It's logic defying. It's strange. It doesn't make any sense. And yet, consistently in this passage, Abram travels and he builds an altar to the Lord and worships. He trusts in the promise of God, even when everything around him says he shouldn't. He has faith. He doesn't know how it's all going to work out, and maybe he has some ideas, but he trusts that it will work out. He responds in faith. Abram goes to Bethel and Ai and pitches his tent again, worships the Lord, and moves on. All right, this will be my offspring's one day. And the reality of needing to find food once again moves him along. But he worships, even though there's no land to be had and there's no offspring yet. So what do we do with this story of faith, of a strange calling to a strange land from a God that is relatively unknown, whose voice would have been unrecognizable? We look and we see that Abram is called, and Abram, like I said, really has no particular qualifications. He does not have an MDiv. He does not come from the best seminary. He doesn't have the best worship practices. In fact, he's not even in the right religion at the beginning of the passage. He's an unlikely candidate. Surely in the entire world there was someone more qualified and more ready than Abram. There were kings, there were nations, there were good economies. And yet God calls Abram and says, "You, I'm going to come into your life and I'm going to totally rearrange it, but I'm going to bless you." Like I said, the first 11 chapters of Genesis tell the story of how humanity fending for itself was not exactly a good thing. We don't exactly do a good job. And chapter 12 comes and God says, "I'm going to put my hand in. I'm going to help you out." It's God's gracious action. And as we sit here as the church, I remember distinctly before being ordained, you sit there in the pews and you think, "This is great, but just not me. I'm not really called like the church thinks of calling and so on. I don't really have that skill set. I don't do this." But the reality is, the question is never the qualifications of any of us. I'm thoroughly unqualified. The question isn't the qualification. The question is the call of God and his faithfulness. It's not the qualifications. It's the call. And just like Abram, just like with Moses, just like with the prophets, just like with the disciples, and with all believers since, God doesn't call the qualified, he qualifies his called. Because it's not our power, it's not our skills, it's not our doings, it's his authority, it's his power, it's his spirit. It's him looking at us graciously and saying, "You're not getting this right, but I'm going to step in." You know, we have this myth that if you just work hard and you pull yourself up by your own bootstraps and do the right thing, good things will come. Have you ever worked hard, pulled yourself up by your bootstraps, and good things just never came? It just didn't happen. Well, Genesis says that's because we're trying by our own strength. Anything that good that happens in Genesis is God's intervention. Sure, I'm not saying that things were totally bad in the ancient Near East. They had some successes. There were empires. There were things happening. There were economies. But in the big picture, we were just wandering. And so it's not by our own strength, it's not by us pulling ourselves by our own bootstraps, but it's by the grace of God intervening in our lives and supporting us that we're able to do anything of value. The second thing that we can see here is something very, very unique and personal to all of us. So many times we can think of Genesis and the Old Testament as being very far and foreign and remote. Like I said, I had to apologize to Jan for the name of things in there. You have Shechem, you have A, which is still hard for me to pronounce after 2 years of Hebrew. You have all sorts of things. I'll show you my Hebrew Bible sometimes. It doesn't even look like language to us. It feels foreign. Strange stories of strange people on something that we're not even quite sure is that history or not, and that has so much baggage. But look at the story of Abraham. Abraham in a people who just couldn't get anything right, and God intervenes and promises that through you, all peoples on earth will be blessed. And we get to the New Testament and we see that Abraham's faith is traced all the way through Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all the way through the kings. And this kernel of faith brings you to the New Testament. And it brings you to Jesus. And so at Abraham, we see the beginnings of our salvation. Sometimes we can think that salvation starts with Jesus, that we don't read the Old Testament because, well, salvation really starts with Jesus. But we look here at chapter 12 of Genesis, and we see that the very foundations of our salvation, the fact that we are here, the fact that we have said yes in faith to God, doesn't start at Matthew 1:1, it starts even before. That God had in mind to call for himself a people well into history. That promise of blessing to all people is fulfilled even today in God's people, in you, in me, here, now. God had a plan for us back in Genesis 12. And that's an amazing thing to think about, that God's plan was so much larger than we give it credit for. That God's plan stretched back well before Jesus, well before the monarchy, well before the judges, well before anything. And it communicates God's care and his desire for us. God had a plan and compassion. The backdrop of humanity's continued descent into sin, God picks an unlikely candidate. He picks Abram to bring blessing and restoration to all of humanity and to a creation he so desperately loves. So whose strength are we trusting in? Are we trusting in our own, like Genesis 1 through 11, or are we trusting in the strength of a God who calls us to strange lands, to strange ministries, to people that maybe we wouldn't necessarily relate to? By God's grace, we're formed into a community, and it's by God's strength, not our own. And pray with me. Lord, seal this story of faith onto our hearts. Remind us that your call doesn't search for the most qualified candidate Your call searches for your candidates, for your people, for those that you come to save, to work through. Use this word to empower our lives, to be reminded that you are a loving and compassionate God who steps in when we need it most. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen.